Open your Bibles now, please, to the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes. And I'm going to read verses from three different chapters, beginning with chapter number 3 of Ecclesiastes and verse number 17. And then I will go to chapter 8 for verses 11 through 13, and then to chapter 12, verses 13 and 14 for the final reading. And my message for today is entitled Certainty, the Certainty of Judgment to Come. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, the fellow that wrote this, of course, is Solomon, and he's known as the preacher. And he pens these words, I said in mine heart, God shall judge the righteous and the wicked, for there is a time for every purpose and for every work. And then look at chapter number 8, verses number 11 and through 13. Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the hearts of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil. Though a sinner do evil 100 times and his days be prolonged, yet surely I know that it shall be well with them that fear God, which fear before him. But it shall not be well with the wicked, neither shall he prolong his days, which are as a shadow, because he feareth not before God. And then in chapter number 12, the last chapter of Ecclesiastes, verses 13 and 14, the last two scriptures in that book, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this host assembled in this place today. Lord, we're so blessed that so many people love MBC and make it their business to be in the chairs each Lord's Day. And thank you, Lord, for those listening online. We have such a good listening audience, and we pray for everyone that has any part in this great ministry. And Lord, we pray especially for those that may not yet be Christian. They may not yet have experienced the new birth and have assurance of heaven. Lord, help them to decide for Christ. Even today, we pray. And God, help us that are already believers to learn from the message today, the certainty of judgment to come. That day, those days, when you will bring every work into the open. And Lord, every secret thing. Lord, help us to prepare for the inevitable day of judgment. In Jesus' name, amen. Just by way of introduction, this is the 7th in a series of messages on the theme, Judgment Day is coming. You might remember in the first message, we dealt with the fact of judgment. And we found that it is established in scriptures. God cared so much about us, He showed judgment to us in samples, and He teaches us that the coming judgment day is taught in our senses. You know, I've noticed all up through my life that humanity, whether it affects them now or not, it just seems that in all of us is a sense that judgment day is coming. The Bible teaches us that. In the second message, entitled The Judge on Judgment Day, we discovered that the judge will be very God Himself. It will be the vicarious Christ, and it will be the voice of our conscience speaking on Judgment Day also. In the third, fourth, and fifth messages, all entitled The Criteria of Judgment to Come, we learned that we'll all be judged by things written in books. God's written things down in books. And we learned that there's the book of salvation is our name written in the book of life. There's the book of scripture. Jesus said we'd be judged by the things that He said. There's the book of service. What have we done for the Lord Jesus Christ? How have we spent our lives? Have we been idle children in the marketplace? Or have we constructively served the Lord Jesus Christ? There's the book of the saints' outreach. Have we reached out to others with the message of salvation? And then in the sixth message, entitled The Announcement of Judgment to Come, we learned that God clearly, I mean numerous times, warns us of Judgment Day to come. And He wants the knowledge of the coming judgment to affect the way we live, the way we live our lives on earth. He wants our knowledge of the coming judgment day to affect how we lead others. And all of us lead others, whether we want to admit it or not. All of us have an influence on someone else, either positively or negatively. And then He wants us to be able to laugh in joy at knowing that He has taken care of us in the Lord Jesus Christ. And now today in our message, here are the guiding thoughts. First of all, I notice that in the text before us, sinners think that they are going to escape judgment. They've heard of it. They may have even gotten fearful of it. But for some reason, they think, I'll escape judgment. Secondly, saved people must stay right with God. in view of the coming judgment. And then thirdly, sensible people will prepare for the inevitable day of judgment. I mean, doesn't it just make good sense to get ready for judgment day? Look at the text, chapter 8, verses number 11 through 13. The Bible says, because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the hearts of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil. The text clearly tells us what goes on in the minds of sinners. I mean, if you could open up their heads and peer into their brains, somewhere in there you would discover that they're thinking that some way I'm going to escape this coming judgment of God. Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily. Therefore, their hearts are fully set to do evil. Here's what fosters that thinking that I'm going to escape. Let me inject this. It just came into my mind. I remember visiting on a street in Blue Ash, and I met a kind, dear, sweet elderly lady. And we just had a wonderful visit. And during the visit, she informed me, of course she was a widow, but she informed me that her husband that had gone on, he had gone on to be with the Lord, because she said he was certainly a born again Christian. He believed what you're telling me. And I was so sure that surely she's a Christian. But then I discovered that though her husband was a Christian and died a Christian, this kind, dear, sweet lady had never personally been born again, never personally become a Christian. And it troubled me so, and she so allowed me to present the whole gospel story to her. And I just felt sure that this lady would trust Christ. And I'd be able to say, this lady has trusted the Lord. But when it came time for her to pray and call on the Lord, she said, well, I don't really think I need to do that. I think I'm all right the way I am. And I said, ma'am, you just said your husband had gotten born again and he believed the things I'm telling you. I said, why is it that you won't do it? And she said, well, it don't apply to me. I don't know if that dear lady ever came to Christ or not. Up in years. But for some reason, she conceded, well, her husband felt that he needed to be saved, and he got born again, and the preacher shared the message with him. But me, I'm going to escape. It doesn't apply to me. I don't need to be born again. I'm all right the way I am. What fosters such thinking that I'm going to escape the judgment of God? Well, the text gives us some answers. And the first reason people start thinking they're going to escape the judgment of God is because they get away with sin right now. In other words, sentence, he said, because sentence. You might look at that as, well, the evidence has been brought in. The jury has deliberated, and now they've arrived at a verdict. The judgment is read, and now the sentence or the punishment is going to take place. And because right now they're still in the investigative state, perhaps. Right now, God hasn't judged immediately. I get to thinking that I'm going to get out of the judgment of God altogether. That's human nature, it seems. We just get to thinking, well, you know, I know they say it's coming, but I'm getting away with it right now. I think I will escape the coming judgment day. And so it continue on in whatever condition that they are in. And then as we begin that process of thinking, and we minimize the consequences of sin. It doesn't seem to be as serious at all. Well, preacher, I don't believe it's as serious as what you say it is. And in that line of thinking, we begin to have a sin accepting attitude. And then as that sin-accepting attitude is fed and fostered in our lives, we keep moving the line further and further away. And we start accepting everything. And we start living as there's no consequences to anything. Because God said, don't do that, and we're doing it. And because God doesn't take the switch, it's what I grew up with. Daddy beat my legs off with a switch. But because God didn't cut the switch out of the tree and grab me by the arm and apply the switch right now, I think I've got out of it. Let me tell you something. There's nothing like, well, you thought you got out of it, but after you thought you got out of it, Dad remembers that he promised to whoop you. And that makes a whooping all the worse. Trust me, I've been there. They think they're going to get out of judgment because it doesn't come right now. Right now. You know, that's what the apostle said about society that heard the preaching of the word of God. Heard the preaching of the coming again of Christ, why, they mocked. They said, I don't believe that. Preacher said, you preachers have been preaching that my whole life, and it hasn't come to pass yet. That's the thinking. I'm going to escape the judgment day. And the text said, therefore the hearts of the Son of Man is fully set in them to do evil. You know, I was thinking in light of the text, the depths of sin to which man will sink when they believe that they will escape the judgment of God. When I think of the depths of sin that have already been reached in our nation, and you almost think it couldn't sink any deeper, but the depths of depravity in the human heart knows no bottom, it seems. I was thinking in my office like this. Sin is like a monster mean. At first it's feared and dreaded and shunned, but as it lurks around doing us no personal harm, right now it eases its way into our lives. We pet it like a beast. It's accepted and it's praised, and it even becomes cute, and it becomes part of our lives. You know, I'm a dog lover, as you know, and can I say this? There are some of the ugliest dogs in the world. Aren't they? I mean, some of those dogs are just ugly as they can be. But no matter how ugly they are, they may be so ugly. I mean, at first, you don't even want to touch them. But the more you're around them, they become cute and cuddly. And before long, they're up on your breast. That's the way sin is. Now, the dog's not the sin, but that's the way we are by sin. Because it wiggles our way, its way into society. We see that in the moral climate of our world today, of our society today. Sinners think that they're going to get away and there's not really going to be a judgment day. Well, friend, the text tells us that though sentence is delayed, or it doesn't look like you're going to get punished right away, a record's being kept and judgment day is coming. And I'm trying to describe it. A sentence has been promised, but we're out free on bail or on bond. We go on about our daily lives, but then the sentence began. I think that there's something more. I think it's worse to have lived in relative freedom to do whatever you want and then all of it come to a halt all of a sudden and you're punished. That's the mindset of man. You're going to get away. Well, friend, none of us are going to get away. Now, let's notice this. Saved people must stay right with God. You see, we have lives also, and this might shock you, but you're sinners also. You really are. This holier-than-thou bunch, they kind of bug me. Because they're dishonest fundamentally. They believe things about themselves that if they really look in the mirror, if they look down deep in their heart, they know it's not true. So we save people caught up in a world of woe. Look at verse 12. We must stay right with God and ready for the judgment day, no matter what the world does. No matter how deep in sin the world sinks, we must not pet that monster mean. Though a sinner do evil 100 times and his days be prolonged. In other words, he just goes on and on and on and on, and he lives long and he keeps sinning against God, and he doesn't believe God's going to judge him, and he just goes, and we look on and we say, Lord, why are they getting away with that? And it troubles us. And sometimes we say to ourselves, well, it doesn't do me any good to be a Christian and try to live right, because look at them. You know, I grew up hearing this old song, whenever you look around as a Christian and you see the world going awry and sin running rampant and people doing whatever they want and they're getting away with it, seems like. Someone penned these words of an old gospel hymn called Farther Along. Tempted and tried, we're oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never molested, though in the wrong. You know what bothers me probably more so than anything? It's the wrong that people's done. And particularly the wrong that people's done to me after I've done right by them to the end of my strength and not wronged a one of them. But I've been wronged, and it bothers me so badly that they are going on and getting away, and it seems like God's continuing to bless them and God knows they've done me wrong. Well, that situation has been around ever since the church has been around. And I don't know what date the old hymn was penned, but farther along, tempted and tried, we're all made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never molested, though in the wrong. Then do we wonder why others prosper, living so wicked year after year. Has it ever bothered you? It's bothered me. It bothered the songwriter. But though he was bothered and penned those words, he was blessed in knowing Romans 12 and 19. Vengeance is the Lord's. He will repay. And God doesn't pay all of his debts on a weekly or biweekly or monthly basis. God pays his debts often after a lifelong existence. You remember the story in the Bible about going out and hiring people to work? And they worked
from morning to night, and they got paid, and then one come in later in the day, and he worked and he got paid the same, and the other servant said, well, what's going on here? How come he made as much as we do, and we've been at it all day long? God doesn't pay on the same scale that we do. So payday, one of the old preachers in the generations gone preached the message, payday someday. Believers save people. You stay right with God no matter what. No matter what the world seems to be getting away with. No matter how much hell is running rampant in the world. No matter how much you shake your head and say, God, why don't you put a stop to it? Can I tell you a little secret about how carnal your pastor can get sometimes? Some of these people who run our country, if I was God, I'd kill them yesterday. I'd just kick them over in the ocean somewhere. But God's not me, my friend. God's there, and I've got to stay right with God no matter how many times I have to sing the old song, Farther Along. Here's what we must remember. God's judgment is certain. It shall be well, the text says. Notice this. Look, verse 12. In contrast to the sinner that thinks they're escaping and the believer that thinks they're escaping. Though a sinner do evil 100 times and his days be prolonged, yet surely I know that it shall be well with them that fear God. Well, glory. There might be sorrow and sin and trouble galore today, but there is a day coming when the wrongs will be made right. God will judge the world. I'm absolutely certain of that because the Bible says it's coming. The certainty of judgment. I just cannot allow myself to think that they're getting away. You know, there's an old saying, I think of several things. Did you ever hear this old saying, you're getting enough rope to hang yourself? Did you know God does that? You get enough rope to hang yourself. Save people, no matter what goes on in the world. We got to stay right. We can't join the world. Man, we can't join the world. Listen, now it's sad, you see, when saved people, because of all the temptations of the world, and we face them, trust me, and all the cares of life, it's sad when saved people pull away from Christ into the world's way of living. It's sad when professing believers pull away, get out of the church, and take up with the ways of the world. Do exactly like the rest of the world does. Because on the one hand they say, well, God said this is wrong and God said he'll judge. But people think they're escaping. I'm thinking that that's not going to come to pass. And I get to doubting whether God will do what he said he'd do or not, don't we? But we can't allow ourselves to be pulled back in to the status quo. We have to remain and keep our distinctives as Christians in the world, which brings me to the closing point of the message. Let me inject this. I cannot resist it. It's pretty important. It's heartbreaking. Because sentence against an evil work is not the execution of it, punishment of it. It doesn't come as soon as we'd like to see it. Therefore, we're caught up in the system. And we just start fiddling our time away with the world. And Christians, saved people, they stop seeing the need to live right before God. So they join the world. This is one of the things that breaks my heart. After all these decades of pastoring, chances are phenomenal that I'll run into somebody even this week that maybe was saved and baptized, and maybe I also married them. Do you? Yeah, we do. Da 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 da. Baby is born. Another baby is born. Mom and dad got them wrapped up in the world. And they took them out of the church. And now their kids are lost and on their way to hell. And mom and dad is so spiritually ignorant that they don't even see it. God help us, the saved, not to develop the thought of the sinners that we're going to escape judgment. Lastly, I'll close quickly now. I've probably already made some of you angry. Well, probably I haven't. But I may have. Who knows? Sensible people prepare for judgment day. Now, I'll close in just about 5 minutes. Let me give you this. The certainty of judgment to come. Sinners, they think they're going to escape. Well, I'm not paying any prices right now. I'm getting away with it right now. I think I'll continue to get away with it. Saved people must stay right with God, but they don't. They get that same mentality and get out in the world. But sensible people prepare for judgment day. Let's look back at the scripture one more time. Chapter 3 and verse 17. I said in my heart, God shall judge the righteous and the wicked. He'll judge both the Christian, because you're saved, don't mean you're going to get out of judgment. And he'll judge the unsaved, the wicked. There is a time, he said, for every purpose, for every work. Now look at the text in chapter 12 and verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. And probably some of you are thinking right now, I'm glad he's at the conclusion. I don't blame you. I get tired of listening to me preach too sometimes. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Let me give you some closing admonitions. Here's how you prepare. Sensible people will prepare for the inevitable day of judgment. You must first become a biblical Christian. John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, the story of Nicodemus. You can believe in God all your life, but if you can't put your mind and heart's finger on a time, not the calendar date, but on a time in your mind and your heart when you saw yourself lost before God and where you bowed your head and you prayed and you trusted the Lord Jesus Christ and you know there was a change in your heart. If you can't remember that time, if you don't have that time of the new birth, you cannot be prepared for judgment day. If you ignore the "you must be," God's must, can I say, at the expense of making you angry, you're not a sensible person. It makes no sense that heaven is to gain and you don't care enough to prepare for it. You prepare for it by getting born again, by believing in your heart that the Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross and shed his blood for the remission of your sins. And you're willing to confess with your mouth or willing, so to speak, to cross the line and say, "Yes, I want to be in the family of God, and I'm not ashamed to do that." You just step over into the family of God. That's how you become a biblical Christian. That's what you've got to do to be sensible in view of the coming judgment day. And then as a Christian, you must stay right with God and ready for judgment day. Let me give you a passage. 1 John 2:28. Believers, he said, abide in Christ, in him. And he said that when he shall appear, that's in reference to the judgment day, he said, you can have boldness and you not be ashamed at his coming. Abide in him. Mind God. Do what God wants you to do. Obey the Lord. Love the Lord. Abide in Christ. No matter what the world does, you keep on keeping on for God. Every man's work shall be made manifest. That means shown open. For the day shall declare it. Every man's work will be tried. And 1 Corinthians chapter 3 says if our lives has been lived frivolously, uncaring, we've built nothing but wood, hay, and stubble, no reward for eternity. And believer, let me close with this. You say, "Well, I have lived for God a lot of years. I think I can quit now." Let me tell you what happens. Let me illustrate with me. After preaching all these years, serving the Lord all these years, if I get messed up somewhere or another, and I say, "Well, I'm just not going to serve the Lord anymore. I'm just going to sit down." Did you know this? If I've got any reward, I mean, if the Lord is going to give me a reward for winning that soul, all the souls have been saved. The Lord, I know he's got a reward for me. All my faithfulness, all my years, I can throw it all away by quitting. Let me prove that to you. I don't throw my salvation away, but I throw any reward away. John chapter 8. Let no man take thy reward. Let me give you some bad news. On judgment day, Brad, if you mess around and quit serving God, you can't say, well, Lord, I served you 10 years. Don't I get a reward for that? He'll say, well, you would have if you'd have stayed on the firing line. But you know what I'm going to do now? 2 John chapter 8. He said, the reward that you earned, give it to me. I'm going to take it. And he said, I'm going to give it to this other fellow here that didn't quit. Let me tell you something, folks. Quitters are a dime a dozen. It's few and far between when you meet that man or woman or boy and girl. They don't quit no matter what. No matter what the devil does, they don't quit. No matter how wicked the world is, they don't quit. No matter what sorrow they face in their life, they don't quit. No matter if they get mad at God because something didn't go the way they wanted it to, they don't quit. Quitters are a dime a dozen. And Pastor Raines, you sorry thing, you. I sustained you all those years, blessed you all those years. You quit the reward that should have been yours. I'm going to give it to this fellow over here because he didn't quit. That's the way it works. Let's stand.